When our backs were against the wall, and it looked as if it was over, you made a way, and we're standing here only because you made a way.
Well, good morning, everybody. Why don't we stand together? Yeah. Fired up. Psalm 121, I want to set our hearts in motion as we enter in today. Psalm 121, verse 1 says, I lift my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. And then verse 5 says, the Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. I love that. I lift my eyes up to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord. And the reality is, everybody, that our strength is directly connected to what we see. And I don't know how you came in today. Maybe you need some strength today. Your strength is directly connected to what you see. In our worship time, our time together, is a time for us to pause, to lift our gaze to the maker of heaven and earth. And so, God, we come in your name. Lord, we lift up our hands and we lift up our eyes to heaven. And God, I pray that as our hands go up, as our praise goes up, as song goes up, strength and blessing in the presence of God would come down. In Jesus' name we pray. Everyone said, amen.
You are. song we could ever sing. You're worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Spirit of fear, he gave me a spirit of power. My God didn't give me a spirit of fear, he gave me a spirit of power.
this one more time. God didn't give a spirit of fear. He gave me a spirit of power. Oh, God didn't give me a spirit of fear. He gave me a spirit of power. God didn't give me a spirit of fear. He gave me a spirit of power. God didn't give me a spirit of fear. Gave me power.
Hey, can we just celebrate the Lord's presence in this place? Amen. You know, just as we were just declaring that and singing that, I'm reminded of a story in Genesis chapter 8 where Jacob has an encounter with the living God. And he has this encounter, and in this dream, he sees a ladder in heaven. And he sees the angels ascending and descending, going up and going down. And he wakes up, and he has this moment where he says, surely the Lord is in this place. This is the very house of God. That encounter that Jacob had didn't end with Jacob. But in John chapter 1, Jesus makes this, and this has hit me this morning, everybody. Jesus said in John chapter 1, he says, truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. Wow. Jesus said that these angels that are ascending and descending will ascend on him. See, what Jacob saw was a ladder. What Jesus says is, I'm the ladder. I'm the one that makes a way. And the beauty for us, just as we're declaring these things this morning, everybody, Jesus is not just a ladder and a way for us to get to heaven, but a way for heaven to come down on earth right here and right now. And so I just want to invite you, just want to pray for us. And maybe right now in your circumstance and in your life, you need the ladder of heaven in your life because you just need an inbreaking of heaven to come in the midst of whatever it is that you're going through. I just want to pray for us. So every head bowed, every eye closed. And I just want you to, if that's you today and you need an inbreaking of the heaven of God, because you're like, Tony, I need a way through, I need a way out, and I'm stuck, and I don't know how to get out of this. It might be a marriage, it might be a relationship, it might be something financial, it might be a burden. If that's you, I just want you to put your hands out, and I just want to pray for you. There's hands all over this room. No one's looking. I just want to pray for you just to receive. I just feel led to do this morning. Father, I thank you that, Jesus, you said you are the way, the truth, and the life. And God, we just believe right now that you are manifesting yourself, that you're in the room. Lord, I just pray, God, that you would just reveal Jesus to us, but reveal Jesus in us. Father, I pray, God, that the kingdom of God would break through in the hearts of your people. God, I pray that you would break through right now, God, that the ladder that Jacob saw, that we would just, even right now, just sense that over our lives, God, that there's things that you want to do to make a way. And so, God, we need a way made for us. And I pray right now, God, that you would come in a powerful way over marriages in this room right now where they see no way out. God, I pray right now over parents who are praying over sons and daughters who have gone far that they see no way. God, would you make a way? Father, I pray right now for those of us that have found ourselves in some kind of financial situation, God, that even by that, God, by your hand, that the ladder of God would be over their life. God, I pray for those who are struggling with anger and fear and disappointment and depression. God, I pray by the grace of God that there would be a ladder from heaven, and God, that you would come and fill us up with the love of God. Father, I pray that where there's a spirit of fear, that there would be a sound mind in Jesus' name. So, Father, we thank you for this moment. We thank you, God, for revealing yourself to us. And so, God, we just ask, King of glory, enter into our hearts. King of glory, enter into our lives. We crown you as Savior, as Lord. And we thank you, God, that your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out. Thank you, God, for your love that's in this place today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Can we give Jesus a round of applause one more time today? Amen. Amen. Well, hey, everyone. So good to worship with you. Before you're seated, turn to someone you don't know. Welcome them to church, and we'll continue this morning. Well, good morning, everyone. How are we doing? Try that again. I know y'all doing better than that. How's everyone doing this morning? So good. Well, if we haven't met yet, my name is Tony, and I'm the lead pastor here at Church of the City. And welcome. If this is your first time, we're glad you're here. You can be a lot of places on a Sunday, and if you're here this morning, we're honored that you're here. And we're not going to have you stand up or do anything like that, but if you're here, maybe someone invited you. Maybe you came reluctantly. However you're here, and we're glad that you're here. And if this is your first time, we've created space for you. As you leave, exit out those doors after service to the right. There's a guest area. We have some staff and volunteers that would love to meet you, answer any questions you might have. And you can hear a little bit more about something that's actually coming up in the life of our church. It's called Intro to Church of the City. And we do this at strategic times, and Intro to Church of the City is for anyone and everyone who's just interested in hearing more. You're not signing on the dotted line to become what's called a stakeholder. It's just an opportunity for us to introduce the story and introduce the heartbeat of Church of the City to you, and that's one of the best ways we know how to do that, and you can get connected with other people at Intro. And so we just want to invite you to be a part of that. That's happening on August 13th here in a couple Sundays. It'll take place at 12:45, just a few moments after our 11 o'clock service on the 13th. Child care and lunch is provided, and so if you just get a free lunch out of the deal, that's awesome. We'd love to serve you in that way, regardless of what the future might hold. But we do ask that you register. So there's a QR code there that would allow us to prepare for child care and for food. But we would love to see you there if you're interested in what it looks like to make Church City or home, or just hear more information. And so if that's you, we would love for you to be a part of that. Sound good, everybody? Yeah. Also, as always, we always want to mention one of the ministries here at Church of the City is our prayer ministry and our prayer team. Men and women who have a heart to pray, that have been trained to pray. They're not just anyone who says, yeah, I'd love to do that, although we all should do that. These people in particular have a huge heart and burden to pray. And just as we prayed earlier in the service for God's kingdom to break through, if there's anything or any way we can serve you in the place of prayer to just believe God to move mightily on your behalf, we would be honored to do that. And so there's a prayer room right over to the left. You just need to go in there, and there's people that would love to pray with you there. Also, speaking of prayer, one of the things that we're doing as a church, and we're on rhythm now, so every first Thursday of the month, starting this month, we are having what's called Pray First. Jesus said to seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you. We don't want prayer to be our last resort, but our first response, everybody. And so on August 3rd, this upcoming Thursday from 7 to 8:30, we're going to be in this room praying together, worshiping together. And what we're going to do, our prayer target for this prayer meeting, is we're going to be praying over all the students and the schools and the faculty, if you're a teacher, and just giving our prayers over to the Lord to believe God for all that he wants to do this year. As far as school goes and education. And so we'd love for you to join us to be a part of it. Child care is available, first come, first serve. And so more information, you can scan the QR code there. Just one more announcement, and then we're going to take our offering. We will jump into the Word. In a couple weeks here, we do this a couple times a year. Again, very strategic, because how many of you know summer is ending and the fall is upon us? So the summer is bye, as far as I'm concerned, and we've got maybe a week left, and so have at it, but once the fall comes, it's here, and it's quickly upon us, and we know that oftentimes there's things that we need healing, but there's steps of growth we want to take, there's people we want to get connected to, so we want to provide an opportunity to do that. And so over the next two Sundays after both services, we're going to have what's called Connection Sunday. And so next weekend in particular, after both services, we're going to have some of our support communities like Celebrate Recovery. I knew I'd get a shout out from the divorce. Come on, y'all. Come on, Celebrate Recovery. We have Divorce Care that's going to be here. Freedom Prayer. which, by the way, are Freedom Prayer Ministry. Freedom Prayer is a personal ministry time that just walks you through removing things that are preventing you from fully abiding in Jesus. And it's a powerful time. We're trying to find more and more spaces and train more and more people up because more and more people are getting Freedom Prayer. And so we want to encourage you, if you have questions or what it looks like to be a part of that, they're going to be available next weekend. Wholehearted Counseling, which is a counseling center here that meets in our building, their staff is growing as well. They're adding a new therapist that specializes with working with children and teens, and so we're excited about that. So they're going to be around next weekend for you to get connected, ask any questions. And then the following Sunday on the 13th, we're going to have our community groups, our Bible studies, and maybe you're just interested in what it looks like to maybe start a group. We would love to talk to you about that. So that's going to be happening over the next two Sundays. Sound good, everyone? Awesome. Well, hey, let's prepare to give our tithes and our offerings this morning. We do this every weekend. And as always, multiple ways to give. You can give now in the service by downloading the COTC app. There's boxes in the back. You can also give online. And just as we prepare our hearts to give, you know, when God talks about giving in his word, he does not just in terms of giving in the context of sacrifice, but also he speaks of giving oftentimes in terms of sowing. A sowing and reaping. Well, what does that mean? I just want to read a verse to us. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. You just hear this as we give today. It says this, the point is this, that whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. So making the distinction between sacrificing and sowing, I think is important for us because when you sacrifice something, you're laying it down and you don't get to pick it back up. When you sacrifice something, oftentimes you might not see it again, but when you sow something, not only do you lay it down, but you also put it in the ground with an expectation that something bigger and better is going to come on the other side that's going to come forth from that sowing. Our garden is just shy of the Garden of Eden this summer, y'all. We have been giving out zucchinis like it's cotton candy. I don't know about y'all's garden, if you garden, but we have a garden, and it's interesting that when as we're harvesting these zucchinis, we didn't plant zucchini. We planted zucchini seeds, and we have so much more zucchini than seed that we planted. And the reality is I would have never seen and been able to give away all these zucchinis if I didn't plant the seed. I want to invite us, for those of us, when it comes to giving and generosity, is that the principle of sowing is not just some life principle, but it's a spiritual principle. And there's no seed that's been sown that we need something for God to rain on. And so when we plant our seed in the ground by faith, God will water that seed. And if you're like me, oftentimes I'll get frustrated when I'm praying for a harvest of something and I'm not getting it. But the reality is that I can't be upset that God hasn't given me a harvest on a seed that I haven't planted yet. And so I want to just invite us that the only seed that germinates is the one that we plant. There's an old proverb, and we're going to pray and we're going to jump into the word. There's an old proverb that says the best time to plant a tree is 20 years ago. The second best time to plant a tree is today, which means generosity begins right where we're at. And so I want us to read this generosity liturgy as we give because we want to be a people who are generous. So let's all lift up our voices. We're going to read this together. Let's go. It says this. It says, what we keep in our hands is all we have. What we sow is what God multiplies. Let's read it one more time. What we keep in our hands is all we have. What we sow is what God multiplies. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, God, as we just take a moment to reflect on the harvest that you've given us, all the things that have touched our hands. God, it's something that you've provided. You've resourced us, but you are the source. And so, God, I pray that as we sow, I pray that we would do so cheerfully, faithfully, trusting in you. And, God, I thank you that you are the one that oversees the seed, the time, and the harvest. And, Lord, thank you that you're the one that's in charge of providing the harvest. whenever that is and whatever that looks like. And so, Father, I pray that as we give and as we sow, that the windows of heaven would be opened up over our lives, that our generosity would not just be something that we reap, but it'd be something that there's an extension and an impact that goes beyond just us, that other people are touched and impacted through the things that you've called us to sow. And so, God, I pray that the deeds and the fame of God would be known in our time through our generosity. Thank you, God, for every gift and every giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, y'all. We are closing out and landing the plane on our Living and Active series. And we've got none other but our very own Pastor Brendan bringing the word. Let's welcome him up as he brings it.
All right. Good morning, Church of the City. How are we doing? Good. Like Tony said, my name is Brendan, and I do have the honor and the privilege, joy of my life, to serve city students. That's our 6th to 12th grade ministry. And just a quick highlight to parents or students in the room, if you haven't jumped in with us before, this next couple Wednesdays, actually the next three, are going to be amazing and such a great on-ramp to come in. We're going to be kicking off back-to-school bash, and we're going to have small groups launching. And so this is the time. If you haven't jumped in with us, come check it out. 6:30 Wednesday night. We'd love to have you. But really pumped to be up here this morning. I'm excited to close out this series, Living and Active. And so if you haven't been with us over summer, or you maybe this is your first Sunday with us, really this series has kind of been getting after what it says in Hebrews, that the Word of God, the Scriptures are a sword. It's living and active, and it cuts between soul and spirit, bone and marrow. It can read us. Can read our hearts, it can read our souls. And so just getting to hear from the different teachers, kind of reflect on the scriptures that have so ingrained in their spirits and their hearts, and just getting to hear the story of how that's been their reality. And so today I get to do that with you guys. And so this message is special for me because it's the message I feel like that changed my life. It's where God met me, it's where God shaped me. And so I'm really excited to share it with you this morning. So if you would stand in the honor of the reading of God's word, we're going to start in Psalm 78, verses 1 to 8 this morning. It says this, "Give ear, O my people, to my teaching. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings from of old, things we have heard and known that our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from their children, but tell to the coming generation the glorious deeds of the Lord and his might and the wonders that he has done. He established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers to teach to their children, that the next generation might know them, the children yet unborn, and arise and tell them to their children so that they should set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments, and that they should not be like their fathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation, a generation whose heart was not steadfast, whose spirit was not faithful to God." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. I'm going to pray for us this morning as we get started. So, Father, we just thank you just for the privilege of gathering, for the privilege and honor of being together as the people of God to worship you freely, to worship you with passion and zeal, to worship you in the goodness of who you are, God. And so we just pray, God, that the rest of our morning, the rest of our time together, Holy Spirit, would you move and illuminate your scriptures? Would they read us? Would they search our souls? And would we grow into the ways of Jesus based on your teachings? Be with us in this time. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen. All right, so I've been a parent for about 5 years now. And being a parent is one of the most eye-opening experiences I have ever done in my life. It's literally the best of times and sometimes the worst of times. If you're a parent in the room, you know what I'm talking about. I have a 2-year-old named Ben, and I have a 5-year-old named Luke. I think we got a picture of my two cute guys. They're rambunctious. They got a lot of energy. Ben on the left is just a ball of chaos. He's just a tornado wherever he goes. And so over the spring, we got bunk beds, and we put them together in the room for the first time ever. And, you know, like he went from a crib to a bunk bed. And so it was like all about trying to get him to stay in his bed and not climb out, right? And so I'm sitting there, and I'm talking to him, looking him in the eye. I'm like, "Hey, son, like, if you get out of bed, there's going to be consequences. Like, I don't know what else to tell you." And he registers. He's understanding me. He's tracking with me. He looks me dead in the eye. He says, I'm going to get out of my bed. It's like, what do you do with that? I was like, that's such an alpha move. Like, I'm proud of you, but like, that was, I'm not even mad, I guess. Yeah, go ahead. Like, I don't know what to do with that. So that's me and his relationship right now. It's give and take, and we're a battle of egos, I guess. So that's where we're at. But my five-year-old, Luke is just so inquisitive and curious. He's learning. He's kind of just at that stage in life where there's a lot of wonder and awe in the world, and he likes to just do new things and try things. And so right now it's like all about Legos, which is cool because even though I am 31, I still love to do Legos with him. So that's been really fun. But one of the harder things that we did, and this was pretty normal, but just about a week ago, we had to take him to Vanderbilt to the hospital, get some testing done on his stomach, routine procedure, nothing crazy, just trying to figure some things out. And there was a moment, I'm bribing him with Pokemon cards just every step of the way, like, okay, we're just going in the room, here's a pack, bro. And so just trying to get him to the moment. But there was a moment for me, like as they're carting him away, that was just really heavy. Like just seeing your little five-year-old go to a routine procedure. So for those of you that have had medical challenges with kids or young kids or have navigated that, my heart goes out to you because that was just something easy and normal, and there was a lot of weight to it for me. And that's kind of where I'm at right now. It's like there's these really great moments and there's really heavy moments, and a lot of it is making me really reflective. Really reflective on what did my parents do? How did my parents raise me and lead? Did my parents do this in this moment? And so I think about the good times and the bad times and the hard times, like how did they navigate things? And really, who am I today because of that? Who have I become because of the way my parents have led and raised me? Additionally, kind of with that as a parent, I also have my role as being a student pastor and getting to hang out with these guys all the time, getting to see 6th grade to 12th grade, see these guys grow up and be formed. And see your guys' parenting in them. And, I think Gen Z gets a bad rap sometimes. I love a lot of things about Gen Z. I love that they are gifted, they're creative. All the memes in the world that you laugh at were probably created by a Gen Z person. Like, they're hilarious. They're inclusive. They want people to feel valued and have dignity. They're about justice in our country, but in our world. They want there to be equal justice for all people. They pursue truth. They want to know how other people think. They want to pursue truth, and they're savvy. They're tech wizards. And there's a lot of other really great qualities, but they're facing unprecedented challenges. They're facing things. I just want to show you a slide. Things I thought of as I've been a youth pastor, student pastor, as I've watched a lot of these guys grow up, the things that they've brought to my attention, the things I've been watching, this is just a small snippet of some of the stuff that I think the young people are facing. Demands of social media, doom scrolling, screen usage, sexuality and gender, anxiety, loneliness, the impact of COVID and social distancing and how that's had an impact on their development, increase in suicide rates, addiction, pornography, self-harm, AI. I wrote this sermon using the help of AI. I'm just kidding. I didn't. But it's like crazy. They do all this stuff. I don't even know, but they're going to have to deal with it. The changing job market, politics, racial tension. I mean, we can go on and on. There's more, and I'm sure you guys could all come up with your own list of things you feel like young people are facing. I would argue that it's one of the hardest times to be a young person right now. It's definitely more challenging than it was for me 15, 20 years ago. It's a hard time right now. Let's look at some statistics. Across America, the 2022 data indicates that there are approximately 18.3 million children who live without a father in the home, comprising about 1 in 4 U.S. children. About 80% of single-parent homes are led by single mothers. Asked about their experiences in the survey about 3 months prior to it, it said 60% reported experiencing depression, 66% reported high anxiety, 75% reported feelings of loneliness, and 35% reported having suicidal thoughts, according to a global youth culture study. One Gen Z study talks about how they're viewing church Is it important? Is it not? They said, 59% said, church is not relevant to me personally. 48% said, I find God elsewhere. And 28% said, I can teach myself what I need to know. So reality, just a quick snippet, quick summary of what Gen Z or our younger generation is navigating right now. This is the problems that you guys are facing. They're anxious, lonely. Their usage of technology is exasperating the issue. The rate at which they're leaving the church is increasing. Parenting in this day and age is different. So it makes me think of an old African proverb that says, if we don't initiate the boys, they will burn the village down. I'm sure that might be true of girls. I don't know, but it's definitely true of boys. Here's what I'm getting at. This is Gen Z's problem to face, but it is not a problem of their own creation. They didn't create this problem, but it is their problem. The reality is they aren't being discipled. And that's happening, hard truth, because we weren't discipled. The problems we're facing were not created by one or two generations, but by a continued deviation from a pathway of being formed into the image of God, the likeness of Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit. We have been walking away from formation as a church. So we can't blame Gen Z for the problems they didn't create. So let's just think about it for a second. Because the question we got to ask ourselves out of that is, how do you know that you're mature? How do you know that you are like Christ? How do you know that you have arrived to adulthood? How do you know that you are a full-fledged disciple? Is there a process? Is there a pathway? Because in my experience, it's been hard for me to find. That there are gaps in who I am as a man, let alone a man of God, because my dad or my mom weren't able to do something for me. They didn't have the tools, or weren't equipped, or they themselves weren't discipled. So how would they expected to then disciple me in the practices and ways of Jesus? By the grace of God, there have been key people that came into my life that bridged the gap for me, but I still have a lot of gaps. And I would argue that maybe that is true for a lot of us. In fact, my argument would be that every issue we run into, morality, gender, identity, sexuality, politics, racial tension, whatever, you name it, I would argue that it comes down to a fatal discipleship problem of the church that has brought us to where we are today. So how do we do it? What do we do with that? I'm going to give just a working definition for formation. Church of the City has a working definition for formation. It's on our website. I'm also going to use this to kind of help us understand. So the definition I'm going with is the process by which we are formed to be like Jesus, and in doing so, our real true self. Formation is the process by which we are formed to be like Jesus, and in doing that, we become the truest version, the real version of who we're meant to be. This is what formation looks like. So in light of all the challenges, in light of all the problems we're facing, and maybe I didn't name the one that you're thinking of, whatever you think is the issue with our world, our day, our culture, our time, Gen Z, millennial, whoever, whether you're 13, 33, or 103, how do we live in the way of Jesus that is so good it actually creates change in our city and in our world? How do we move the needle forward on the spiritual temperature of any generation? The question I want us to ask ourselves this morning is, how do we create compelling disciples? How do we create compelling disciples that grabs the attention of a lost and broken and hurting world? How do we create compelling disciples? To get us going, disciple in the Greek is methetes. I'm going to go with that. Basically means apprentice. Your whole life is dedicated to becoming like the mentor, the teacher, the rabbi. You say, okay, how do you do your finances? Okay, I'm going to do that just the same way. How do you pray? Okay, I'm going to pray the same way. How do you stay healthy? How do you parent? How do you do your marriage? How do you treat A, B, and C? What do you do when you're in a conflict? How do you treat people you don't like? I'm going to follow what you're doing. I'm going to learn it. I'm going to ingrain it. I'm going to become like you, the apprentice. This is what it means to be a disciple. You know, I was a young person in the 2000s day, and there were some really cool things happening in movies back then, all right? In the early 2000s, actually it might have been 99, but there was a reboot of the movie called Star Wars. It's not a reboot, it's a prequel, right? And the first time around, not the second time around, but there was a old guy that became a young guy by the name of Obi-Wan Kenobi, and he had to learn the ways of the Force from his master, Liam Neeson, all right? And around that same time, just a few years later, there was a young guy by the name of Bruce Wayne who wanted to learn how to stay in the shadows and do martial arts so that he could become the Caped Crusader, and he had to learn the ways of being Batman from Liam Neeson. Additionally, at that time, there was a guy by the name of Orlando Bloom who wanted to be a crusader in the movie Kingdom of Heaven, and he had to sit under the tutelage of none other than Liam Neeson. So what is going on with Liam Neeson? Like, what are we missing here? Guy's awesome. But the reality is, Hollywood got something that sometimes I think we can forget. We love a sage. We love a mentor. We desire to have someone as a guide, someone who can shape and mold us and train us in the way that we should go. Maybe you wouldn't even acknowledge that, but deep down, We hunger for it. This generation, this younger generation, they are hungry. They have zeal. They have passion. What they lack sometimes is wisdom and guidance. And they want a Yoda. They want a Qui-Gon Jinn. They want a Liam Neeson, right? And so do we. We're not any different. You see, spiritual formation isn't a Christian thing. It's a human thing. It's everyone. We are all being formed. So it's not, are you a disciple? It's who is discipling you. Because when you wake up in the morning, you are immediately being formed. Your TikTok feed, your news feed, what you go to on your phone, what you do with your time in the morning, who you allow to speak into your life, the relationships around you, the environment you're in, the beliefs you think about yourself, whether from the past or current, the lies that might be churning in your mind, all of that is vying for your attention to form you and make you into something. So what do we do when it comes to formation? In the 1930s, there's a guy by the name of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. A lot of you guys have probably heard this story before. We talk about it a lot here. He's a guy I really look up to. He's a dead guy that's still a sage to me, right? He wrote books like The Cost of Discipleship and Life Together and Ethics and really good stuff. Back in the 1930s, he was a pastor, preacher, teacher, theologian in in Germany in the time of the Third Reich, in the time of Nazi Germany. And he basically started this underground church movement that had a school where he would gather people together. They would live in like community life. They would live together in this space trying to live out the way of Jesus together, and they just kind of did this thing for a few years. About somewhere around 100 people kind of came through these doors. And so at one point, a few of his friends start to think that this is getting like overboard. This is too extreme. You need to dial it back in, kind of go back to normal, go back to your old job. Like, let's chill it on all of the Jesus stuff, right? And so he goes and visits Dietrich, and Dietrich takes him on a journey. They go rowing down this kind of body of water that leads to a hill that has an overlook. They climb up the hill, and he points out, and this is what the historian wrote about this journey, this experience. It says, Bonhoeffer spoke of a new generation of Germans in training. So what they're looking at is a Nazi training ground. There's planes flying over, there's soldiers, boots on the ground, mobilization, training happened. New generations of Germans in training whose disciplines were formed for a kingdom of hardness and cruelty. It would be necessary, he explained, to propose a superior discipline if the Nazis were to be defeated. You have to be stronger than these tormentors that you find everywhere today. This small little group of Christians, of disciples living in the way of Jesus, this has to be stronger than that. What we're doing here, this formation process, this discipleship process, it's got to win. It's got to be stronger than everything else that's vying for our attention. This has to be stronger than that. Whether you're a parent, a student, no matter your age, you need to be discipled and you need to disciple. It's the inherent call of Jesus in this great commission. Go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. I'll be with you always. This was Jesus' last words to us. To be a follower of Jesus means you disciple others. It means you've gone through a process. So I want to use Psalm 78 to set this up. So if you want to turn back there, Psalm 78, I'm going to jump in. First, I want to talk about how this is, so Asaph is writing this, one of the writers of Psalms. And he starts with by saying, you know, give ear all my people to my teaching. I'm gonna open my mouth in a parable. I'm gonna utter dark sayings from of old. Right? I'm gonna teach you a parable, which is basically like it's a story that takes apart complexity. It's what Jesus used. In fact, Jesus quotes this. It's how Jesus taught. He took simple story elements and used them to break down and give understanding. So Asaph is trying to unpack a discipleship process for the people of God so that people would believe in God through the ages. And he's going to do it in this kind of poetic parable that we find here. So it says this, glorious deeds of the Lord and his might and the wonders that he has done. He established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers to teach to their children, that the next generation might know them, the children yet unborn, and arise and tell them to their children so that they should set their hope in God and not forget the works of God. Asaph is speaking for his community and he's showing them that look at the reality of what God has done. Look at his deeds. Look at his might. Look at his works. Look at that. He's given us a testimony in Jacob. That's basically saying he has proven himself trustworthy. His testimony is sure. We can put our hope in him. He's given us the law in Israel. He's given us a way that we can live, that we can go, that leads to a flourishing and blessed life. So Asaph starts us off the idea of knowing how do I get started in a formation process? Where do I begin? It starts with the fame and deeds of God. It starts with the knowledge of who God is. Because when we know who God is, we know ourselves. And I have just a diagram that I want to use to kind of go through Psalm 78. It starts with the knowledge of God. We know who God is. We will know ourselves. But as we read this, you know, the idea of like, okay, so they're teaching, they're telling these stories we've heard and known. We're not going to hide them. We're going to tell. It can easily be like quick to us to kind of read that as, okay, so you're just kind of regurgitating information. You've heard information and now you're telling information, right? Because honestly, that's a lot of kind of how we learn here in the West. That's not the learning style of this day and age. It's not the learning style that Jesus operated in. He operated in a style of discipleship, of apprenticeship. So yes, he would teach things, but he would always give parables and handles, and he would show how to live this out. We see that here as well. But it starts with the knowledge of God. It then moves into the idea that it's not just information, because if it was just information, whatever problem we have, we could read a book about it and solve our problem, right? So if you're having a marriage crisis, you don't need marriage mentors, just read a book and it will solve everything. But all of us know that that's not how it works, right? A book will maybe help us a little bit, but it's got to go way past that. If any one of us we want to run a marathon. All right, let me just watch a YouTube video, and that will teach me what I need to know, and then I will get out there and run a marathon. No, you die. Like, that's just, this is how Richard Foster put it. It's trying versus training. See, it's not about just information download, and if I know something, that's enough. No, it's not just try really hard, and I can go out and do it. No, it's training. And so Asaph is saying, look, you have these fathers that have shown you. They've lived this out. They were a model. They were an example. You've apprenticed under them. You've heard the stories, but you've seen in them. More is caught than taught. You've heard that before? That's the idea here, that they've learned this from the life of their fathers, of their leaders. You know, my wife goes to CrossFit. I do not. And she comes home, and I'm like, oh, you died and came back to life. That's what's happening. You're beautiful. I love you, but you look oh, kind of awful. She did this earlier. She heard me say this to her face, so we're good. But it's crazy. I think it's crazy. But what's really interesting about her, you know, she comes home, she loves it. What's really interesting about her is she is a person who tries really hard. She does. She's got tenacity. She tries hard. She trains harder. She shows up. She's faithful. She's consistent. I want you to see it in maybe a different way. If you're like, where's he going with this? See it, check this video out, and we'll keep going. This morning, you are not expecting to watch a grown man eat broccoli backwards. We all need a little bit more of a maybe Michael Scott attitude when it comes to the discipleship process, when it comes to formation. 1201, bam, blood everywhere. It's about showing up. Yes, it's trying. There is value in that, but it's showing up. It's the training. It's just being consistent. It's just starting. For a lot of us, it's just starting, and then it's continuing, showing up to the gym, showing up in community, showing up in your marriage, showing up for your kids, showing up in our faith. Eugene Peterson describes it, discipleship, as a long obedience in the same direction. Let me say that one more time. Discipleship is long obedience in the same direction. It's training. You're not going to go outside and run a marathon tomorrow without any training. You will die. It's going to take time. And that should encourage us, because this is a process. That's where Pam is helpful in that conversation, because it's not about perfection. It's a process. It's a journey. You know, we think formation, we think our maturity and our growth is going to look like this, just up and to the right. Like, we got this. I'm just going to keep winning, keep increasing, keep growing. And I'll get there. I'll be like Jesus. And we all know that that's not how it is. This is really more realistic as to what formation looks like. It's all over the place. In moments when we think we've figured it out, it's like we take one step forward, two steps back. When Paul is wrestling in Romans 7, when he says, I do what I hate to do. Like, we feel that, if we're just being honest, right? Like, in this process of trying to grow and be like Jesus, there's gaps. There's gaps. So one, be encouraged that this is a process. It's a mess sometimes. But also, we have to wrestle with that inner journey. We have to wrestle with the gaps. We have to wrestle with the realities that maybe are keeping us from being more formed into the image of God. Romans 12 puts it, be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Or the Message version says it this way, you'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what he wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to his level of immaturity, God brings out the best of you, develops well-formed maturity in you. See, the world, we've already talked about this, the world is vying for your attention. They're trying to counterform us. The enemy is going to counterform us. Our human desires, our flesh is wanting to counterform us, to bring us to immaturity. This is where the pain from our past, the gaps in our discipleship and our from our parents, some of us have an orphan spirit. Some of us are held back by shame and resentment and rage and unforgiveness and pride. Whatever it is, we all got something. You know, it's interesting, at the end of Psalm 78, verse 8, you know, after commending the fathers that have taught us the ways we should go, to pass it on from generation to generation, which we're going to come back to in a second, it then says that they should not be like their fathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation, a generation whose heart was not steadfast, whose spirit was not faithful to God. I don't know who exactly they're talking about. Which parents, which leaders, which mentors, which disciplers they're pointing to, but you can feel the gap. And all of us have inherited gaps. You can have the best parent in the world. You could have had the best parents, and you still will have gaps. I am, to this day, wrestling with the gaps that I have. Our parents are human and flawed, and parents in the room, you're going to have gaps for your kids. Disciplers in the room, you're going to have gaps for those that you disciple. And so it isn't being resentful towards our parents and blaming them for our problems. It's just being honest about what you needed to grow and thrive and acknowledging that you might not have gotten it. For me, it happens when I read my Bible to my kids, when I read their Bible to them. Or when they're going through having an emotional reaction and I try to sit and process with them and look them in the eye. When I navigate sexual integrity since I was 14 to now, when I feel like I can't do hard things and I want to quit, and I sometimes feel like I don't have the grit to continue on, those are gaps in my formation because no one taught me how to do it. And I've had to work really, really hard on forgiving my parents for the gaps and not holding resentment or bitterness or even just holding them on the hook, because it's not their fault, it's a discipleship problem. And they weren't discipled either. So it creates compassion for me to them. Ronald Rouser says it this way, whatever pain is not transformed is transferred. Whatever you are carrying right now, it's going to leak out. And it's not the inheritance you want to give those you lead and disciple and parent. So that's why we have to do the hard work of healing from the wounds of our past, getting freedom, taking people off the hook. And I'd love to say I have it all figured out, but I don't. Because if you want to put that graph up, one more time, it's a process. It's a mess. And I'm working on it. So we need two things to transform, to truly transform, we need the community of God. And we need mentors, teachers, leaders, parents, spiritual mothers and fathers. Because here's what's going to happen in real, authentic, true community is you're going to meet exposure where the best of you and the worst of you is put on display. But then you'll also experience encouragement where you're met with grace and compassion and truth and challenge. And we need it all to really, truly grow. It's the idea of I see who you are and I accept you and I love you and I also see who you are becoming. And I am going to do everything in my power to help bridge the gap for you. That's the beauty of community. That's the beauty of discipleship. That's the beauty of discipling and parenting others as we get to bridge the gap. If you've ever spent time in real community or you've gotten married, you find out really quickly that like, oh, this isn't perfect, right? It's messy. The exposure is quick, but it is so needed. I wasn't aware of just how messy I actually was until I got married. Then I became very aware of how messy I am. It all gets exposed in real, authentic life. And thank God, I've had some really, really great mentors in my life. People who took a shot on me, took a risk. And I'm here today because of them. This is personal formation. This is a process we have to go through. It starts with the knowledge of God, the fame and deeds of God, knowing who God is so that we can know who we truly are meant to be and going through the journey, the transformation of personal formation. And then lastly, here for all of us to see, the command for those of us that follow the ways of God is to teach these truths to our children, to the next generation, and the one after, and the one after, and the one after. See, it says, command our fathers to teach to their children that the next generation might know them, that the children yet unborn and arise and tell them to their children. The idea here, this is the parable, that it would continue on and on and on, that it would go beyond us, that it would be a long legacy of truly becoming who we're meant to be in the likeness of Jesus. This is what we get to do. Not just for one to know, but many more to know. That we would live a life worth replicating. That it would inspire others to see the goodness of God, to know God because of how we live. So the final spot, final part of the triangle for us is to disciple others. Starts with the knowledge of God, fame and deeds of God, knowing who He is so we can know who we are. Going through a process of personal formation so that we have something to offer that we can disciple others. So that then they will go and encounter the knowledge of God and personal formation and disciple others. Knowledge of God, personal formation, disciple others. And it goes on and on and on and on to the end days. Every one of you in this room right now is equipped enough to disciple someone. To move the needle forward for someone else to become more like Jesus tomorrow than they were today. You have the ability. And the greatest thing is that if you would just show up, the Holy Spirit is going to show up. If you say yes, if you step into discipleship, if you step into truly parenting, the Holy Spirit is going to back you up. He's going to empower you. He's going to equip you with what you need. He's going to guide you. He's going to lead you into all truth. He's going to comfort you when it doesn't work out. Holy Spirit is going to be there every step of the way if you say yes. Now, I just want to talk for a second to the parents in the room. Parents in the room, your role is sacred. I want you to feel that. I want you to just burn for the idea that your role as a parent is sacred. It's the highest calling. You are the primary discipler of your children. Spurgeon puts it this way. The more of parental teaching, the better. Ministers and Sabbath school teachers were never meant to be substitutes for mother's tears and father's prayers, or father's tears and mother's prayers. Your role is irreplaceable. The reality is, and I know you probably don't want to hear this, maybe you do, maybe summer's been a little crazy, 90% of the time you have with your children is in the first 18 years of their life. The window is small, but your impact is massive. Teach them in the way that they should go. Train them up. Have a pathway of formation for your house. Do a Bible study. Make them do it. Sit them down. We're going to read the scriptures together. We're going to pray together. It's the most important thing you could do. Take them to Dunkin' and Chick-fil-A and have good conversations with them. You're welcome. Be inquisitive. Be curious. Don't speak. Just ask questions and listen. Give guidance and feedback when they ask for it. I know there's times you got a parent. I know it. Give them opportunities to do hard things. Give them chances to lead and serve. Take them out of Spring Hill. Go to Nashville. Go to another country. Put them in spaces where they have to do hard things. Tell them you love them and are proud of them. More than anything else, say those things. And I feel like I need to say this. Parents, if you feel like you've missed it, missed the window, maybe made mistakes, maybe you weren't there for important moments, it's never too late. It's never too late to return to your children, to repent to them. It's not the prodigal son. You can be the prodigal parent and take ownership and step in. It's not too late. Students, one of the greatest regrets in my life is that I didn't honor my parents, that I didn't receive more of what they were willing to give. So if your mom or your dad or your aunt, your uncle, your grandma, your grandpa, whoever, they're like, let me take you to coffee, let me take you to lunch, you jump on that opportunity because your window is small too. Let's make the most of it. Whether you're a parent or not, I'm going to close with this. All of us are called to disciple. Be the person that you needed when you were younger. My life was changed because people took a risk on me. And because of them, I got to turn around and do the same. I've got to be a student pastor for years, but I got to be a student pastor for here for 7 years. From sixth grade to graduated. We got to celebrate them a couple months ago. I have a picture of some of these guys, seniors. Special for me. But they get to go and be greater than me. They can go and do more than I can. And that's the point, that's the goal, and that's the hope. So they would go further beyond and do greater things for the kingdom of God. My challenge for all of us, be a disciple. First, be a disciple. Go through a process and then make disciples. Be a disciple who makes disciples. You know, we got Connection Sunday coming up. There's so many opportunities to jump in. You know, I don't have 300 mentors on a Wednesday night. I have 300 students who need mentors on a Wednesday night. It tells us the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Kids City, community life, leading a community group. I just want you to think about, and who has God called you to learn from, to disciple under? Whose life is so inspiring to you? The life of life following Jesus is so inspiring to you. You're like, I got to have it. And then who's God showing you got to bring along with you? And would you step into those moments and those opportunities and those processes, those times, those journeys? Jump into a group, join a team, try it for a year, go to CR, go for a year, do freedom prayer, do it 3 times, do whatever it takes, try something and don't give up, but keep showing up. Go through a process and bring people along with you. Follow Jesus, become more like him, and in doing so, your real, truest self. Isn't that compelling? And we feel like that will change the world. if you want to take your communion elements. You know, this meal represents, I mean, all of this, the knowledge of God, the personal formation, discipling others. This is what Jesus did. This is who he is. You know, Jesus came down and became human so that we could come and be truly human, so that we could be forgiven and freed and set right. Jesus came to bridge the gap, to deal with our hearts, to make us whole. And this meal represents that. On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread. So this is my body, which is broken for you, broken for me. Let's take and eat together. He then took the cup. So this is my blood, which is poured out for you. Forgiveness of sins, healing. We're a new creation in Christ. We're adopted into the family of God. It's all because of Jesus. Let's take and drink together. I'm going to pray. God, thank you so much for your son, Jesus, who left heaven, left you, came to earth, became human, so that we could become human and join you in heaven. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you are. Holy Spirit, we just invite you to lead us into this next season. What process are you calling us to? Where do you want to form us? Who do you want us to become? How do we become more mature? Holy Spirit, lead us to that. And show us who to bring along the way. Show us who to invite into discipleship, to be spiritual parents. God, I pray for the mending of any parent-child relationships in the room, that you would bring restoration and reconciliation there, that there would be a sweetness. It's not too late. Thank you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, have your way. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Well, hey, I got to give one quick instruction. If we're about to have a stakeholder meeting, if you are a stakeholder, you can go and grab your kids, then bring them back in here for our time together. With that, grace and peace. We'll see you guys next week for a brand new series. Love y'all.